Okay, so we are being recorded for posterity's sake. And the hopes, these are the true hopes that after a year of this, I'll get an Emmy. So yesterday we culminated the Parsha of Yisro, a very fundamental Parsha, because it is where they actually got the Ten Commandments. So we have a lot to talk about. So the Torah begins. The Jews are now in the desert. They survived the splitting of the sea. The Egyptians were drowned, etc. And now Yisro, the priest of Midian, the father-in-law of Moshe, heard that the Jews went through, left Egypt. The Jews had split the sea. They had beat off the Amalekites. And he decided it's time. It's time for me to bring Moshe's wife, Moshe's kids, back to Moshe. See, Moshe left. He didn't want to take his wife into Egypt. He tried to take, and Aaron yelled at him, "What are you doing?" So he sent her away. There's commentaries to say that he actually divorced her. And the reason why he divorced her is he didn't know if he was getting out of this alive. So he didn't want his wife to be an aguna. I am told, I don't know if this is accurate, that there are soldiers in the Israeli army that divorce their wives before going into the front lines, because if their body disappears, they can't remarry and they're chained.
There's a lot of sad stories.
Some put the cavity chest.
So you're being recorded, man. So Yisro brought back Yisro, and he was the Kohen Midian. He was no slouch, Yisro. So Moshe, who was clearly came from the tribe of Levi, he was nobility, married a daughter of nobility. And his father was the chief, Kokoam, right, of the tribe of Midian, of the country of Midian, the town of Midian. I'm not sure exactly. She brought his two kids. And Yisro came to Moshe, and he says, "Moshe, I've come, your wife has come, and your children have come." And the reason why he said it separately is that I've come. You don't want to come for me, that's fine. Your wife. You don't want to come for your wife? Okay, your kids. So Moshe came out, and they kissed and they hugged, etc. Moshe told them the whole thing of what happened. And it says by Yichad Yisro, Yisro got goose pimples. And Rashi slams Yisro. Personally, I would also get goose pimples when you hear this, but Rashi says, yeah, you know why? The reason why he got goose pimples is because he was pining for Egypt's loss. That you really, you know, Yisro originally was a Egyptian, and you can't trust an Egyptian. That's what Rashi says. And Yisro said all the right things, right? Yisro said, Baruch Hashem. This is where we get it from, by the way. Yisro said, Baruch Hashem, blessed is God that he saved you, etc. Now I know that God is the greater from all other gods. And he didn't mean it that God is one, just a great God amongst gods, but rather Yisro said, I've dabbled in different gods and different theories, etc. And I realize that there's no comparison. And Yisro and Aaron and all the elders came to eat bread and to have a meal with together. And it says, so the commentaries say that this was actually Yom Kippur when Yisro came. However, The Moshe didn't tell anybody. Only Moshe knew it was Yom Kippur. So Moshe hadn't had a chance. He came down the mountain and he bumped into Yisro. And this is the chronological order of this. Moshe himself didn't eat. The next day, the day after Yom Kippur, Moshe sat down and he started to, it was his job to adjudicate various disputes. And Moshe was the only one. So Yisro told Moshe, what are you doing? Why are you doing this? Why are you sitting down and there's long lines to see you? He says, because when the people come to question God or they have a dispute, either way, I'm the man. So yeah, Yisro, which was an amazing thing, Yisro said to him, you're not doing a good thing. First of all, he's an interfering father-in-law. But secondly, Yisro was, because he came and he basically saw it objectively. So the Jewish people, they're involved with Moshe. Moshe took him out. But Yisro saw something objectively. He says, you're going to wear yourself out. Not only you, the people. You can't just have one person service, right, 2 million people. He says, what you got to do is you got to delegate. And what you have to do is every big claim you'll do, and every small claim they'll do. Set up a hierarchy, set up, you know, the Supreme Court justice instead of Superior Court and Civil Court, etc. That was Yisro's idea. He said, ask God. Anyway, God acquiesced and Moshe did it. Moshe, however, had changed it. He said that he's not going to do every big thing and every small thing because that seems to be little smaller monies. Right. So in America, you have small claims court. In Judaism, you can take somebody to court for a dollar. It's going to cost you a few hundred dollars, but you can take someone to court for a dollar because if there's thievery involved, for example, or alleged thievery, it's $1 is just as important as $500,000. So Moshe said it's not about big and small, Yisro. It's about tough, greater, the complex cases versus simpler cases. Anyway, God said it was a good idea. And because Yisro didn't only criticize Moshe, and Yisro actually gave him counsel, the parsha is called Yisro. So it's interesting, and we discussed this yesterday. In the political world, right, everybody said what the president's doing. But that was true when Trump was in office, Obama was in office, it didn't matter. Right? Which party? Everyone, you're doing it wrong. But nobody came up with any concrete solutions how to do it right. Their platform was that you're doing something wrong. Yisro, he was credited with actually giving sound advice that works. And so that's why the parsha is called Yisro. So, It was on the third month. Jewish people leaving Egypt, and it was on the first day. It was Rosh Chodesh Sivan, and they came to the desert of Sinai, and they saw the mountain, and they camped opposite the mountain. The Torah uses the term Vayichan singular, not Vayachanu plural, is because there was no fights. It was actually everybody for a short period of time got along.
United.
And God, that's when God gave them the Torah, because God saw it as an opportunity. Listen, if they're united, this is the best time to give them the Torah, because if they're divided, I'm pained. I don't want to give them gifts. Moshe went up to the mountain on the Rosh Chodesh, and God told him, this is what I want you to tell the people. You're going to see me. And me, the same person that took you out of Egypt. If you hearken to my voice and listen to me, keep my covenant, you are going to be the chosen people. And you're going to be a kingdom of priests. You're going to be the lamplighters. You're going to be the moral conscience of the world, which is good and bad. You know, the moral conscience of the world, but you're also not everybody likes that, right? Hitler didn't like a moral conscience, so Hitler got rid of us. And he says, this is what you have to do. To ask the people if they're willing to accept the Torah. Moshe went down to the Jewish people, and they said, Kol ashadib Hashem nase, whatever it is that Hashem says we will do, which was an incredible declaration of faith. They didn't say, what is it? What's written? No, let us see the fine print. Okay, we'll sign, but if you take out paragraph G and paragraph L and paragraph N, they just said, no, we're in. We're in like Flynn. We will accept the Torah. So Hashem said, okay, that was very tough. Nase, we will do the Nishma, and then we'll hear, right? That was considered a tremendous, a statement of faith. So Moshe went back. Moshe went back, and God said, okay, go back down again. Moshe was up and down the mountain quite a few times. And he says, go tell the people to prepare for the Torah giving.
Amen.
Yeah.
When Moshe climbed the mountain, climb up, how did he climb? The mountain is high, the rocks and stuff. Were there stairs, or he just climbed with his hands on?
No. We call it a mountain. It was probably better to be called a large hill.
I've seen it. That's a mountain. If you to climb from point A to point B,
it wasn't rock climbing. It wasn't rock climbing. No,
he just walked up.
He walked up. First of all, the same God that did all this to Egypt can help him. There's an expression in Yiddish. I'll just say it in English. It says, when you're bound from above, you will not fall below. So that
could have raised him, maybe, with the...
I think he had to start walking up the mountain in his sandals.
Escalator.
And then he made it, clearly he made it. So Hashem said to Moshe, tell the people they should prepare. 3 days, they need to go to mikveh, they need to put their clothing in the mikveh, they need to not, they weren't allowed to have any sexual relations, and they had to put a barrier around Har Sinai, a fence, so because anybody who went on the mountain during would die. So it was on the third day, and everybody had gone to mikveh, etc. And God started, before God gave the Torah, he made it thunder and lightning. And there was earthquakes, and the mountain was trembling, and people were afraid, and they weren't coming out. And there's a midrash that says that they were in the tents. And it was Moshe had to come down and say, come on, guys, God is waiting. So
didn't they all die?
So we're not there yet. So he schlepped them out of their tents, and Har Sinai was on fire, right? And there was smoke, and there was thick smoke, and there was clouds, etc. And there was the shofar. So imagine just the thunder, lightning, earthquakes, fire, smoke. And that was the atmosphere. And Moshe went up. And the question is, why? Why give it in such a, why not give it with serenity? Why not give the Torah with just simply a beautiful day, birds chirping, right? In La Jolla, California.
Butterflies.
Right, or butterflies, Aruba, and the flamingos. Why give it like this? So God was actually teaching the Jewish people a lesson. And the lesson was, life ain't easy. Accepting the Torah is not necessarily going to be an easy ride. It's going to be a tough existence, right? It's going to be a hard, throughout our ages, right? We were attacked because we were Jewish. And it's interesting, for the most part, it didn't matter if we were observant or not. It didn't matter if you were kept Shabbat, didn't keep Shabbat, kept kosher, didn't keep kosher. The very fact that you were part of the chosen people and the moral consciousness bothers dictators, it bothers communists, right? It Venezuela, Chavez, it bothered him, because he was corrupt. He was morally corrupt. And it would bother, right? It would bother any anti-Semite. There is an anti-Semitism out of ignorance, fear of the unknown, but we're not talking about those. Those are just, you know, ignorant. But we're talking about those that are smarter than that or more knowledgeable than that. They are bothered by the moral consciousness. Or the other way to be an anti-Semite is if you can make money off it, like Abbas, like Arafat, like Sharpton, like Linda Sarsour. These people are just opportunists. Anyway, and Hashem, it says in the Midrash that they stood under the mountain. So it means that they stood around the mountain, but according to the Midrashes, they literally stood under the mountain. God ripped up that mountain and held it on top of them like a dome and said, I'm serious, boys. You keep the mitzvahs or there's going to be destruction. So anyway, Moshe went up and he was about, God was about to give the Torah, and Hashem said to him, go down again and warn them once again, don't come on the mountain. So Moshe said, they know. He says, go down. So Moshe went down, and Hashem told him to warn everybody, even the Kohanim. So Moshe went back up, and Hashem gave the Ten Commandments. And according to the Midrash, this is how it went, is that Hashem said first the Ten Commandments, all in one breath. He said it all at once, which a human being cannot do. And then he started to extrapolate. And he said, I am the Lord your God. And when he said that, so they heard all the Ten Commandments, even though it was incomprehensible. Then he started to extrapolate one by one. I'm the Lord your God. And the Jewish people died. It was a mass death. Their souls left their body. It was too tumultuous. It was too much. And they were revived, resurrected. And God said, do not have any gods beside me. And they died. At that time, Moshe ran down the mountain, and the people said, and they were resurrected, we can't do this anymore. One time we're going to die, one time too many. And, you know, we don't, how many lives do we have? Nine. If cats have nine lives, we have seven, right? He said, you speak, Moshe, you speak. So they heard the two commandments from God, and the rest they heard from Moshe. And it's interesting, the word Torah, has the numeral equivalent, Aleph equals one, Bet equals two, of 611. So Torah Tziva Lanu Moshe, 611 mitzvahs Moshe commanded us through God, but two we heard from God directly. Now the Ten Commandments, God gave, there were 10. The first five were man and his creator. The second five were interpersonal, interpersonal, do not kill, do not steal, etc. And by the way, killing means murder and stealing means kidnapping. Because stealing, just like murder is, you get a capital punishment. Kidnapping is also capital punishment. Stealing money is not capital punishment, right? You have to pay back, you have to get sold as a slave, you have to pay back double, etc. So the idea is that there's the relationship between man to God. You have to have that. And God tells you to believe in God. You believe in God. Don't have any of the gods. You don't worship even yourself. And keep Shabbat. Don't use my name in vain. And et cetera, which all have ramifications. So for example, when a Jew goes to court, raise your right hand, please. You say, do you swear? So your response is, I affirm. You know, we just, as Jews, we don't swear. Even if it's not in vain, we just don't swear. You know, if we can get away with affirm, we get away with affirm. I remember once I had to appear in court, and anyway, I come up there and I said, okay, there's going to be this discussion about swearing and affirming. And it was the judge. He said, raise your right hand. And then he looked at me and he goes, just state your name for the records. Right? I think it was Irish. So, maybe it was Jewish, I don't know. Anyway, so I didn't have to swear. So that's the idea. You cannot just love God. You also have to deal with people correctly. And likewise, you can't just deal with people correctly and have no relationship with God. God gave you both. Right? And it is explained that the first one, I am the Lord your God, I am the Lord your God, is the head of all the positive commandments. It through that commandment is I am the Lord your God, and therefore you keep Shabbat, therefore you keep kosher, therefore you have a mezuzah, therefore you do tefillin, therefore you do pilgrimage, and therefore you separate tithing, etc. All positive, right? And then they do not have any other gods beside me. Do not have any other gods beside me. That is the prototype for all negative commandments. I took you out of Egypt. Don't have any other gods beside me. And also don't do this, because that means you're not listening to me. You're not accepting that I don't. You should just want me, right? You should be lovesick, as it says in Tanya. So Herman points out that the word for I am the Lord your God is an Egyptian word. The Hebrew word is Ani. God said Anochi. And Anochi is an acronym, as it says in the Gemara, for Ano Nafshi Kesavis Yehovis. God is saying, I am giving you my soul. I'm giving you soul. I'm giving you who I am, and it's not just, I'm not just giving you a gift that I could afford, giving you a nice diamond ring for $2,000, but I make $300,000 a year. God said, I'm giving you my essence. I'm giving you whom I am. Anyway, the commandments are: I'm the Lord your God. Don't have any gods beside me, right? Don't use the name of Hashem in vain, right? Remember the Shabbat, keep it holy, and honor one's parents, which are a co-creator. On the other side, it says don't murder, right? Don't commit adultery, which is interesting. The second one is don't be disloyal to God, don't commit adultery, don't be disloyal to your spouse. Do not steal, kidnap, right? Do not bear false witness, do not be jealous. Do not covet. Now, it's interesting. Now, there's so many other things God could have put down in these Ten Commandments, but he chose these 10 for specific reasons. First of all, on the left side, between interpersonal, these are the hardest, right? Sometimes you want to kill somebody. You can't even think it. And you can't even embarrass somebody, because if you embarrass somebody, the blood leaves their face, and they become ashen, and then it goes back to their face, and they become, so basically you displace blood, right? So that's the coveting is, take that as an example. Do not steal. So if you kidnap, the next thing you're going to do after you kidnap is you're going to lie about it. And well, you swear, tell the whole truth, nothing but the truth, that you had nothing to do with the kidnapping. Absolutely, I have nothing. So it leads to the next thing, and he says, how does this all come about anyways? Because you're jealous, and all these are a denial of God, and I'll explain. Jealousy. Let's take jealousy. When a person is jealous, right? When a person is jealous of somebody else. Why do they have this nice car and I'm driving around in a why does Lenny have a Lexus Sport and I have a Prius, right? Why does this one have this and I'm driving in a Hyundai
Lexus CT200,
which is for sale? Why, right? Why does this person, look at this person's house and look at the hovel I live in, 5,000 versus 2,000 square feet, et cetera, on and on and on. And that leads, jealousy, right, is basically denial of faith, right? If a person believed in God, the God and divine providence, that part of God, that God does what God does, and God does it for the reasons he does it, which is above our pay grade, then you'll be content. Beza Asher, who is wealthy, who's somebody who is satisfied with their lot, and they're not, and it's hard. That's why it's in the Ten Commandments. It's because you know, yes, he could have put mezuzah there. He could have put kosher there. He could have put, you know, so many different things. But he wanted to appeal to the human frailties first, right? Don't kill. It's easy to take a human life. You just need a gun, right? You can't do it. So these are the Ten Commandments. And when Moshe came down, they were on two separate stones, man to God, which means that you cannot love God, daven, study, and do whatever God wants, have the nicest Shabbat table, but you do that by stepping on another human being. No, because you have the other set of tablets. And likewise, you cannot save the whales and Darfur and Black Lives Matter and et cetera, and be an atheist, right? It doesn't wash either. You have to have a relationship with man and have a relationship with God. You have to have both. You can't just have one. Moshe, God finished the Ten Commandments. The thunder and lightning stopped, the smoke went away, the fire went away. And they claim, by the way, today there is a mountain, I believe it's in Saudi Arabia, that is burnt on top. If that is they claim that that is the real sign, and not where we think it is, but rather a couple hundred.
The location of that mark.
There's a theory out there that
it's just, so nobody really knows.
It's a theory, it's a theory. Anyway, Moshe remains on the mountain for 40 days. Moshe doesn't come down right away, but God told him that before we start, Moshe, before we start me telling you all the commandments, there's just a few things. Because the people saw me, they saw my essence, right? In the next week's parsha, it talks about how they saw clarity. They saw God's throne, the footstool of God's throne. It was a sapphire stone or something. So they saw something that most people do not see, right? In fact, by the Ten Commandments that the people heard the lightning and saw the thunder. That's what it says. So they saw things that are normally heard, and they heard things that are normally seen. They saw things that most humans don't see in a lifetime. They were so spiritual, and they saw ethereal things. And they were so distant from physicality that they weren't in tune with physicality, and they only heard it, which is less of a connection. Hashem said, look, the couple things I want to get clear right away. One of them is, don't make gods of silver, and don't make God of don't make gods of silver or gold. You saw me. There's no place for idolatry, right? Rashi learns it completely different. Or Rashi learns that God was talking about the keruvim, the cherubs. That in addition to idolatry, the cherubs must never be made of silver, ever.
Wow.
So the cherubs symbolize God's connection with us. This is where God spoke to us. And it should never be made of silver. So the question is why? So I saw something from the Rebbe, and the Rebbe says as follows, is that children are pure like gold. And one should never say, I'm not gonna do this and that with them. I'm not gonna send them to yeshiva because it costs a lot of money. Rather, I'm gonna send them to Hebrew school. And I'll send it to public school, which is included in my taxes. It says, don't be cheap on kids. Don't be cheap on their relationship with God. Zahav, gold, throw as much money as you have to. And don't do anything with silver. So Rashi learns is talking about the cherubs, and he's not the only one. He says, the other thing says that I want you, when soon you're going to make an altar, that when you make an altar, I want you to make sure that the altar is not made up of stones that are cut with the sword, or any iron, a sharp iron rod. He says the story is such is an iron rod shortens one's life, a sword, a dagger, a spear shortens one's life, and the altar is designed to increase one's life. So therefore, I don't want anything. And that was true of the entire temple. They did not cut any of the stones with metal. They cut it with glass. They cut it in the times of Solomon with the shamir worm, with the acidic worm. And I said acidic, not chasidic. Acidic worm. And so they never used any metal. And the last thing he said, that when you do make this altar, and it remains to be understood why he brought these three things up. And the last thing is when you do make an altar, he says, I want you to make a ramp, not steps. And he says, even though the Kohen is wearing pants, if you make it with steps, then the genitalia moves. If you make it with a ramp, it's more modest. And God, you know, and it's a ramp, it's a concrete ramp. Who cares, you know, what a concrete ramp sees or, but this is what God wants. He says that one has to be, privacy is even to stone and mortar. And that's how the parsha ends. He taught these three things, it's unclear. But we do learn one thing that's very important. He says that when you make this altar, and he says, and you bring up the sacrifices to the place that you can say my name will be mentioned. So we know from here that God's name, so we don't pronounce God's name. We pronounce a basically a euphemism of God. When we say Ado, and then we say Nai, right? Ado. That's not God's real name. Right. Yes, false witness can be perjury. Absolutely. So we don't say the name. We don't say it as written. The Kohanim were allowed to say it only in the temple. So when they bless the Jewish people, right? Yivarechecha Hashem Yishmerecha, may God, may Hashem bless you. And guard you. They actually said, when they said of Hashem instead of Adonai, they used God's name proper, and as that was the only time they were allowed to use God's name was in the Holy Temple. So Moshe was up there 40 days and 40 nights. The first thing God taught him, aside from this, as was next week's parsha, is God taught him civil laws. Right, because there's a practical reason for this. You Jews are going to be living together, and you got to make sure God taught them torts, that if your animal bites you, another animal, or if your animal bites you, these are the laws. If you if somebody steals something, you can't repay it. You know, you're going to have to be sold to slavery to repay it. But when you have a slave, this is how you have to treat your slave. So the first thing God taught them was civil laws. There's three types of laws. There's civil laws, right, man to man. There's testimonial laws that we keep Shabbat because God rested on the seventh day. We keep Pesach because we were redeemed from Egypt. And then there are chukim, statutes. We don't know the reason why. Right? As an example, kosher, we don't really know the reason why. Shatness, we can't wear a clothing that has wool and linen woven together, only if it's woven. If it's not woven, you can wear a wool jacket and a linen shirt and you're no problem. You weave it together, all of a sudden, you know, you break God's heart. We don't know why. We don't know why pig is no good and camel is no good, but cow's good. Right? They all reek. Right? We don't really know why. And we can give theories, et cetera, but we don't know why. Right? Oh, well, because we only eat domesticated animals. Well, a chicken will eat a chicken.
Well, look at the pig. Look at the pig. The pig is the root of all viruses and diseases. If you look at the pig and what's going on in the world today, there's no flu this year, Rabbi, because no people from China are traveling to our country. So there's no flu this year from the pig.
We got
right. So I hear you. However, if you keep kosher, and that was the argument, by the way, the argument was the argument of the earlier Reformed Jews was kosher was only given because of Steve's argument that a pig, if you eat pig, it's not refrigerated properly, can have trichinosis. Right? It has nothing to do with refrigeration. It has nothing to do with sanitary. It has nothing to do. It's because, and this is the reason, we don't eat pig because God said so. We can theorize, but we must realize that these are not the reasons. These are man-made theories. The definition of a theory is an unproven fact. Right? A fact is a fact. A theory is unproven fact. So it's not because of diseases. That's a side benefit, right?
Well, maybe that's a warning. Maybe that's a warning to give you the idea that God gives you some indications of certain things that do happen in the world, and there's a reason for it.
Right. So for health reasons, it can't be for health reasons because the Jewish diet is one of the unhealthiest diets there is.
Right? Really?
And it's all kosher. It's all kosher.
I don't believe that.
You know, the story of Hanukkah, that the oil lasted for 8 days. I'm telling you, in yeshiva, one piece of kugel, you stick a wick in it, it could have lasted for 8 days. And no miracle. Steve, what you're doing is we don't do.
I know, I'm not disagreeing with what you're saying, Rabbi. I agree 100% what you're saying. But I do believe in the Torah versus what you just said. I think it's a very healthy way of living. I just don't think that people are utilizing. Look at the revival of olive oil and wine and what people do and the health benefits. And if you do follow the Torah, it is very healthy because it signs a sign that bread is just not to eat bread all the time. It's something that should be taken in moderation and meat in moderation when you celebrate Shabbos. That's why you see a lot of Hasids. They live to 100 years old because during the week, they don't eat like a ganav. And only on Shabbos they indulge in their lifestyle on holidays and stuff like that. And you see all these skinny guys, you know, walking around. No,
I completely do not ascribe to what you're saying. I mean, so I think okay, valid point. But the Rambam says that the Kohanim who worked in the can you make me another one? Yeah, please. So the Kohanim that worked in the Holy Temple, these Kohanim were so sick from eating all this meat and this oil and these pancakes and these griddles and the griddle cakes. And they were so sick that they actually had a 24-hour urgent care, 24-hour urgent care on the Temple Mount, in the Holy Temple, because the Kohanim was so sick from all this kosher food that half of it was offered to God. They had cholesterol issues. They had constipation. They had bowel issues. They probably had Crohn's. They probably had Crohn's, and it's all because of the daily sacrifice. You know, that keves, that nice sheep that was slowly killing them. So anyway, who knows? We'll talk more about the different laws next week. Two questions that warrant an answer. Steve asked, what happened to Tzipporah and the kids? So Jethro went away for a while. He went to try and convince the other nations of the world that lived in the desert, the nomads, at that time of monotheism, of one God. He did come back. He definitely came back, and he was allotted a portion of Israel, right? He was given a land in Israel, Jethro, thank you. Jethro and his family. Tzipporah remained with the Jewish people, albeit Moshe and Tzipporah never had sexual relations again. And we learn that from a later thing. In other words, they slept in separate beds and they, but that's not a directive for everybody. you know, that's attention, Jewish women. This is not a directive, but they Moshe and Zipporah, we're not together. Do not live together as husband and wife. I do not have sexual relations with that woman, right? So Moshe could have said it, not you know who. And the other, someone asked another question. Let me see, it was another question. No, that was it. Someone wants me to mute.
I have one more thing just to add to the Parsha, if I can. And yeah. The last thing was the Haftorah that is for the Parsha of Isaiah. And if you go to the last section of the Torah, the reading of the altar, it talks in Isaiah about the angel with the six wings and to cover himself right up to make sure that he wasn't naked in any ways, even in front of God, Hashem, right? So the six wings or the flapping of the wings, yeah? The flying, right. The wings to fly and the two to hide the feet.
Rotators,
and the two to hide, right, Rabbi?
Yeah, they rotate.
Dedication to the altar, right?
Yeah, that's how they connect it. So, yeah, I much more about it, I don't know, but yes, it says about a lot of Isaiah is you just read it and you try and understand it the best you can, like Shavuot, the Haftorah for Shavuot, right? It also talks about the rotating wings of the various different because they saw the God. So the Haftorah on Shavuot is about the angels being revolving around God. You know, it was like drones around God, basically. And it's very difficult to understand exactly, visualize anyway. That's it. Another excellence in broadcasting. It's in the books. And this is Yaakov Limba, or Rush Sacks. God bless, guys. Please, God, tomorrow we're going to continue modern-day Israel, 1 o'clock on the Facebook page. Be well.